I've dealt with a lot of situations that made me, I dealt with a lot of situations in my life that, you know, made me be afraid of, you know, and it hurts differently when you got kids.
All right, guys. So in this podcast, this is a really special episode. We are testing, getting overall guests. And this is probably going to be the only podcast episode like ever where you're going to hear a combination of battle rap.
And marketing.
marketing, battle rap, come up stories, Transylvania, the whole nine. It's intense.
It's super intense.
So you'll hear a combination of, you know, like it got emotional at points, but yeah. You know, towards the end, like it's all about marketing, and marketing is about relationships. And sometimes, you know, like when your relationships can be volatile. So that's where this conversation is going, guys. And I hope you guys enjoy it. Would love to hear your feedback. And yeah, Dre, any beginning yeah, words?
Just would love to hear your feedback on this episode. This was super amazing. Juliana is such a cool person. I can't wait for you guys to jump into this episode. We really covered so much, and just can't wait to hear your feedback. So let us know. And yeah.
So without further ado, here's Juliana Jackson, CBO queen, e-commerce queen, queen of LinkedIn, queen of rap, Southern rap, and we'll have her take it away.
Hi guys, how are you doing? I was looking for the Jamaican.
Juliana.
No,
Juliana Jackson is not Jamaican. She's
not Jamaican.
But
no, listen to no one. What tells you?
Yes. So, Juliana Jackson is a CVO e-commerce expert, right? She's been in the marketing game for a while. She'd be really, really interesting to just overall get her perspective. She lives in a completely different part of the world. We're like right now, I'm in New York, Dre's in Pennsylvania. She's all the way in fucking Romania. It's amazing. Yep. So really curious to hear about her journey, really curious to hear her take on CVO, e-commerce, and then some gems that she has for you guys within the marketing space. So Dre, take it away.
Yo, so first question that I have for you today is, how did you even get started in digital marketing? You know, everybody has a different story whenever they're getting involved in this space. You know, like me, I learned from a course. How did you get started in it?
Wait, I actually have a question to preface that. Juliana, can you introduce yourself in your own words? Because I might have just butchered that entirely.
It's fine. First of all, thank you for having me for the first episode of your podcast. I'm glad and honored to be here. And it's going to be probably very hard for you to top this episode, but that's cool. So just remember me.
We got you.
I'm kidding. So I'm Juliana. Also, you know, people know me by the CLV lady. It's because I talk about customer lifetime value most of the time. I am the chief evangelist for OmniConvert, which is a technology company based in Romania, which is in Europe, in Eastern, Southeast Europe, for whoever listens and doesn't know where it is. I get that often.
Represent.
So, yeah, I mean, I'm working in e-commerce at the moment, and it's just to get tell you how I got started, it's hard because I don't know. I guess it all started from the fact that I come from a place, you know, where there weren't many job opportunities, you know, in the sense of a career perspective. So I always, you know, wanted just to get out of the town first. I wasn't thinking so long term back then. I was, when I finished high school, I said, I'm just going to move to Bucharest, where I'm living right now. So I wanted to be a lawyer because lawyer had money. Lawyers have money. So I said, you know, I have a big mouth. Why not? So I went to law school and, you know, I got in. But it was a big school and I didn't have money and I wasn't, we don't have like a college credit here, which is great because we don't have to pay them when we're 40. And it's hard. So I took a job when I was in the first year of college, and it was a sales job and it was paying very good. No contract. I was selling commercial space on the internet for real estate. So I was calling people from the newspaper that were selling their houses. And back then, you know, in 2010, internet was like, you know, not so embraced here in Romania from all points of view. So it was something new to put your, you know, property online and sell it. So right. I was calling people that were trying to sell their houses and trying, you know, to convince them to put it online because the internet is the future. So I was making a lot of money from, I wasn't going to college that much. Plus it was like, I just went in a few classes in the first year and it didn't, you know, really fit with who I am. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, being a private college, everyone was, you know, rich, which I wasn't. So it was very hard for me to fit in. And also, you know, I was with someone at that moment and I got pregnant when I was 21. So I had my first son and I had to stop everything I was doing. So when I was pregnant, I had to make money somewhere. So I did this thing on my own where I was doing data mining and research and I was selling lists online of leads. Wow. So basically I was making long Excel.
What year was
2012.
That? Okay. Damn. Like a decade ago, basically.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm 30. I'm not 20 anymore. But yeah. So I was, you know, doing this and I was taking care of my son. And, you know, it was hard after my son was like 2 and I was trying to get back to work, but no one was going to hire me because I didn't have enough experience. Because the place where I worked to sell those stuff, I didn't have a contract. You know, they was just, you know, paying me for being there. And we were calling off some old ass Nokia phones, you know, 1320 Nokia phones. You would have, you know.
Gotta love the Nokia. It don't work.
The good old days.
Yeah, it was that blue Nokia that was lasting for 3 years of the battery. So I got hired in a shoe store and I was selling shoes. I was like the Al Bundy of Romania. And I worked there and I was washing toilets and getting, you know, bigger ladies' shoes on. Like, it was exactly like that.
Wow.
And then, you know, during that time, you know, I was doing a lot of stuff. I was just trying to support, you know, my child. I ended up working in a call center because I was looking for jobs. And I was doing, you know, I was a sales rep. And from that, in 6 months, I got to be the sales director because I was selling very good. And then is when I learned about project management. Then is when I learned about contracts and I learned about, you know, managing a team and how you should, you know, approach projects and whatever, because I had like clients from the telecom industry and e-commerce industry. Mm-hmm. So I really learned everything on my own. I just read. I read books. I was watching YouTube videos. I was trying to learn from everyone that I got in contact with. But in that year when I was working there, I got divorced from my first husband. So I was broke with my son. So I had to make something to, you know, raise my son because it was just me and him. So I got hired in corporate because I hated corporate.
I
hate corporate too. Don't worry.
I don't really fit in.
I don't fit in either.
So I got hired in corporate on a ridiculous salary for Romania. For you guys, it's probably your rent. But for Romania, that's a lot of money. Rent in Romania is $300 per month.
Per month, wow.
Wow. Yeah. I need to move to Romania.
I know.
$300 a month.
Yes, that's the rent here.
Yeah.
That's how much I pay
that's
for rent.
That's insane.
What? I know. Wow. So that's why the salary that I have was your rent in New York back then. So it was a lot of money for me because yeah. I know what the rents are. So I had that, you know, I had that salary. But I didn't last in there because people were so different than I was used to. I'm used to working in startups. So I was with my son. We just had a place to live. I had to, you know, figure out everything. So I said, fuck it. I'm going to start my own company. So I started the consultancy company because what I learned in the call center as a sales director, when I worked there for like 2 years, I understood how you can get clients, how to deal with them, how to deliver, how to manage a team. So I learned a lot of shit. So I said, why can I not reproduce that shit on my own? So I started the company. I took money from my brother. Some of it, he got it back. Don't worry for who's ever listening, he got it back. So I started my company. And in the first months of it, I was broke as shit. All the money that I have was on my, you know, just to feed my son, my oldest. But then, you know, I started getting clients. So for 2 years, I was doing really good. And I ended up working with so many e-commerce and, you know, companies and software companies. And I was basically helping them bring a new product to the market. Because what I'm really good at, and that's, you know, what's my job right now, is that I can move crowds in a direction. I don't know how I do it, but I think I'm the most ultimate hype man in the world. I'm like the MOP e-commerce.
That's an insane analogy.
I will come, you know, and anti up.
Yeah.
My company went to the shithole because I couldn't scale.
Yeah.
So I said, fuck it, you know, I'm tired. So I worked with cloud companies, with software as a service, platform as a service, whatever, with companies in Switzerland, America, everywhere. So I always had the passion for music, right? So I said, fuck it, you know, I'm going to go and produce music. And I did.
Wow. Let me just recap all of this. Let me do the recap.
You wanted to know this.
This is insane. You went from, all right, law school, then to dropping out of law school. You had your first kid and you're like, all right, shit, I got to get a job. I got to make this money quick.
Got to get it.
You went through a divorce. Then from there, you started working all the way, crazy jobs, cleaning toilets. You even worked at a shoe store,
I was cleaning the toilet in the shoe store that I was sharing with my colleagues.
Oh my god, you were cleaning the toilets at the shoe store at the same time you were studying up, like you were like researching things, you were learning, right?
Yeah, definitely.
That's a hustle. And then from there, you eventually became director at a call center, and then from there, that's when you started working corporate.
Yeah,
and then you were like, you know what? Fuck this. I'm going to start my own business. You started your own consultancy. Your consultancy was specifically for e-commerce and SaaS?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And e-commerce was very new back then. People weren't, you know, this was 2016, right? So people were not that, they weren't now, nowadays, right now. So it was like barely getting into it. And people were selling online insurance, you know, shoes maybe, but like super restrictive. So e-commerce back then was very tough. So what ruled the world back in 2016 were SaaS companies. It was sexy, it was new. Cloud was just making way in 2015, 2016. So I got in the market in the best time of my life because I got to learn about the cloud infrastructure and cloud technology exactly when it appeared. So the funny part is that one of my clients in the call center was a company from Switzerland called Cypherspace. Mm-hmm. They will never listen to this, so I'm not going to shout them out. But I used to work for that company, and the CEO of the company was the first person that brought internet to India. This amazing guy.
That's crazy.
It was this guy with long hair. He looked like Jimi Hendrix. He was like the Indian Jimi Hendrix.
Wow.
Yeah. And, you know, like he taught me mostly everything I know about infrastructure as a service because he was selling, bare metal servers. So he wasn't selling cloud. He was selling, you know, real bare metal servers. So I used to work in that industry a lot. And I used to, I brought to market softwares that were managing clusters of servers and high availability. And I worked in that industry a lot, right? Because that's what was working back then.
Yeah.
So from that shit, I just got fed up because it's so hard to do what you think is good in terms of marketing, to put a software to the market and do that whole go-to-market process with founders that don't get it. Because in my opinion, the biggest problem of everything in the world that includes a company is the founder, because the mindset of a founder is very biased and is very, how can I say this, limited. Mm-hmm. So there's this book that I like called The Fourth Agreement. I love this book. So in The Fourth Agreement says that, I think the name of the guy is Luis Garcia Martinez, something, the author of it. So in Fourth Agreement, it says something like, when we are born, we are taught everything and we are accepting, we are agreeing, right? This is the first agreement. We are accepting what other people are teaching us. Mm-hmm. So how do you transfer that to an owner? An owner is always obsessed because it's, you know, when you're an entrepreneur, you're very lonely. I know that very well. It's super fucking lonely and you need people to keep you sane all the time. That's why I have, you know, people that I'm friends with on LinkedIn because, you know. So when you deal with an owner as an entrepreneur yourself, when you're trying to sell your services, being, you know, PPC or SEO or whatever you guys, you know, are doing, mm-hmm. you have to always fight the mindset of the owner. And the yeah. biggest challenger for a status quo in the mindset is data. Yeah. It's facts. So mm-hmm. when you make a person feel that their comfort zone is shattered, they become defensive. So it's very hard for you to, you know, as a data-driven person or as a data-oriented person to plead your case. So if we translate that to marketing, we can understand why the marketing, you know, culture as it is right now. I always say it's a culture of one-night stands and quickies, because our main focus, and you won't like this, Cynthia, I know, is to sell. You know, but just to get at your question, because I went like this, my life is very crazy. So no one asked me in a podcast about this. And if, you know, and I have a group of people that actually listen to whatever I do in these shows, and, you know, they like me, and I'm very grateful for these people. I don't know why the fuck they like me, but they like
me. You have the sauce.
Don't get lost in the sauce, right? Don't ever get lost in the sauce.
That's a big one.
My life is crazy, and I don't usually get asked this question, but I jumped from all this craziness of dealing with mindsets into music mm-hmm. because music was the only thing that saved me from the environment that I was in with my family, with what things were there. So if I didn't have music, I probably wouldn't be here right now talking to you guys, because the environment where I come from, and I'm not only talking about the streets, but I'm talking about, you know, the whole family stuff.
Yeah.
It's not one that encourages growth necessarily. Mm-hmm. It's more like encouraging being stagnant, right? So just staying and, you know, dealing with it.
Yeah. Right.
So I needed a break. And in those years when I was working as an entrepreneur, I saved money because I knew better than that. So I saved some money. So I said, you know, I'm going to work for, you know, in music. So first of all, I got hired in a company that sells music distribution. I got hired because I reached out on their chat website. And I said to them, listen, you're not doing this right. Let me do this right for you. And I sent them a business proposal. And I got hired in like 3 days. And then I just started meeting artists. And from that, I started producing music. I met someone from London. It's a very good friend of mine. So we produced a lot of music together. And I'm happy that I worked with J-Ru the Damager. I worked with Easy Moby. I worked with DV Alias Christ. And I worked with a lot of people from New York, basically, from Brownsville, from Queens, and so on. And J-Ru lives, by the way, if you know J-Ru the Damager, you have to know him, because I would be very mad at you. Come clean.
I'm sorry. I'm dropping the ball right now.
Do you know too, Dre? Is it just
no,
me?
No, I don't
yeah,
know.
I have no idea. So, I just want to recap everything.
I'm sad.
I jump around. She's mentally beating my face in. Just want to recap everything. So you... All right. So you had your own business. You're still learning. You're still growing. You were a consultancy specifically for e-commerce. You had mentioned this one thing that I really love. And just to emphasize, it's the Four Agreements. I love this book by Don. I pulled
Duncan
it up.
Garcia.
I pulled it up so I don't butcher it. Don Miguel Ruiz.
Oh, shit. I was look out.
Don Miguel Ruiz. I love. Also, I follow his son on Instagram. He's amazing.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, really, really cool stuff there. And you mentioned like the mindset when it comes to working with founders. You know, I work with e-commerce companies. It's really important for me. Like I see myself as a lawyer or like a surgeon. So whoever I work with, I really need to mesh very well with the owner. We need to be on a similar mindset. We need to just based on how her overall mindset with marketing, that's how I know advertising is going to work, because I don't think about things short-term. We're going to have some short-term wins, but that means nothing if we're not playing this longer game. You know, like I believe in, you know, running ads profitably, right? But sometimes profitability is a long term. Sometimes it's in the span of 3 months. Sometimes it's the span of 6 months. You know, it's not something that you can necessarily see on a day to day basis. Although, like when you're running a profit and losses report, you know, obviously you don't want to be in a loss all the time. Mm-hmm. But, you know, like sometimes you need to take a step back and look at that on a week by week basis, biweekly, monthly, quarterly, in order to assess really overall impact. So 100% agree with marketing. And like, I feel like we're on the same wavelength of going straight for the sale. Like I like to think that my goal with marketing is to bring it back to building relationships.
Yep.
Yeah.
I 100% agree with that as well. You know, cause I just, if the person that I'm working with, if we don't have like similar alignments in what we're trying to accomplish, it's going to be hard for us to even accomplish anything. Right. Because I also, because like, it's just like a, it's my personality as well. Like, I want you to see the bigger picture. So I'm going to constantly keep educating you on that bigger picture. And if you don't get it, it's just going to hold us both back. So I think it's really important that whenever you're working with someone, you guys do have the same mindset. Cause I won't work with anyone if the mindset isn't there. You know what I mean? Cause I'm actually a really big believer that your mindset is everything. You know, like if you, how you view what you do. So one of the things I like to say is your perspective drives your performance, right? How you view what you do dictates how you do what you do. And if we don't have the same views, then I'll refer you to somebody else, right? That probably can get you what you're looking for, but I don't want to feel like, I like pressure, right? But I want to feel good pressure that we're trying to accomplish something bigger. You know what I mean? So I 100% agree with both of you guys.
Yeah. I think I would love to ask you. So I also don't want to just completely gloss over the fact that music saved your life.
Yeah.
Music was that thing for you. Honestly, for me, it was, sorry.
I was here dealing with myself and I'm like, you got handy.
No, you're good.
You're good. You're overthinking
music,
it.
Music saved your life. For me, marketing saved my life in a way because marketing for me gave me confidence and scaling a business and honestly making money for other people and making money for myself gave me that confidence, right? Like I'm pretty, do you feel similarly? Like I know music saved your life and I know that you were involved in, like, it sounds like you were not only producing music, but you were like advising in a marketing sense, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So I got a job that paid my salary because music ain't making money at all. Like,
in music you invest,
you don't make money at all. So the most I did in music was $3,000 that I did on a contract to do to produce an album. I was like the Puff Daddy of UK for a minute. It felt good. But because I was the executive producer on this album, which I sent you guys the links to, you know, to check it out. Yeah, but the only reason I went into music is because all my life I felt like I was in a rush to get somewhere and I always had to fight for every little shit that I had. So I just said, you know, like I need to breathe. Obviously, the first thing that came to my mind though is like, yo, I gotta get paid so I can raise my son, but I need this
time. Gotta get that cash money.
Exactly. So I had this job and I was doing customer experience, which was something, you know, new back then. It wasn't as, you know, as a buzzword as it is today. This was in 2017, right? Yeah. So it wasn't such a buzzword as is right now. So I was reading because I always like reading. I read a lot. So I was reading and I was trying to implement this and working with artists as a client. It's like a purgatory. It's the worst thing ever. You have people that come and bargain for you on the chat, on the tickets chat. For $20, but then you see them on Instagram with ice and blings and
all
whatever.
This stuff where, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And then they come and bargain with you for $20. Like, what do I get on this money?
Right.
It's like the worst
bro,
thing.
Bro, don't you have an Audemars? Like, you could afford to pay me some bread. Like,
exactly. Like, you're out there, you know, looking good and shit and dripping all those statuses. That's why I don't have Instagram anymore. I used to have 10,000 followers on Instagram. I deleted that shit. I couldn't deal with it. I couldn't like music. I love music. I love hip hop, but I would never go back to doing it. The only good thing that I got from music was my husband. That's the only thing, you know, I got from music.
The little baby we just saw now.
I'm talking about music. The baby doesn't come from music unless it's what's his name, mom. What's his name?
No, I was saying that music gave you your husband and the little baby, the cute little baby that we met earlier.
No, the baby came out of me annoying him for 3 years to have a baby.
That too.
I get what you're saying, but you know, it's funny. Oh, right. No, I can relate to that, by the way. Like, I can relate to the whole music thing because I felt as though every time when I was growing up, you know, I'm from a neighborhood where people do a whole bunch of crazy stuff, you know, selling drugs and gangs, all that stuff, right? And so, like, the people that you see that are successful, like, when you look around, you think of what success is. Like, me growing up in the hood, that's what I'm looking at. But I didn't want to ever gravitate towards that. I didn't want to be involved in that. Like, I have friends right now that I haven't seen in, like, 20 years because they're locked up in prison, right? But I didn't want to go down that route. So for me, it was like I started writing raps because I started writing about the things that I would see. So that's how it started for me. It was like I was writing raps about what was going on and what was happening and all that stuff. And so, like, for me, it always was like a coping mechanism that I got to sit down, write something, really put my heart into it, and then it was done. And the other thing that I used to like as well is, you know, like in that neighborhood, like, it's, you know, there's a lot of aggressive things, a lot of aggressive people, fights, gunshots, shootouts, all that stuff. But I didn't want to be involved in that, right? But what I did like, because I'm super competitive, just from my family, my upbringing, and just my environment, what I did like was rap battles. So, like, in 2019, for example, I had a rap battle when I stopped rapping. I had a battle and I won $500, right? But the thing is like, it felt super good because, like, it's like you're taking your words and you're trying to show people, like, I'm better than this person. You still have that competitive aspect, but it's no violence, right? You can rap about whatever you want. You know what I mean? But there's no violence. So I 100% relate to, like, the whole music thing because it's just a great way to vent, you know?
We're dip into this more. So, like, coming from adversity, like, me and Dre don't necessarily come from money, you know, but we worked our way up. How has adversity made you a better marketer?
Ooh,
that's a great question.
Yeah. I think about that myself a lot too. Yeah.
So how do I put this?
Just say it like it is.
Okay. So, I mean, there's two ways to look at stuff. You can either let hate or, you know, drive you to do better, or you can let it eat you, right? So I always had, until recently, until a few years ago, I always had this need of proving myself. Coming from where I come from, we have to work 10 times harder than other people just to be at the same, perceived at least, you're never going to be at the same level, but perceived at the same level as other people. So I am, as a person, and I don't have no fucking shame to admit this, I am traumatized by being broke. And I'm traumatized about having to look for a job because it wasn't, you know, as good as it would be right now when, you know, I'm super happy where I am in my company, but I get a lot of people trying to offer me a job. I never had that before. And I'm traumatized about the idea of being broke and alone. And I just, for me, the way, I don't know if it's marketing, but work in general, everything that I do, I always have that. It's like, I feel like I'm a slave to this trauma. And that's the something I'm, you know, I'm still fighting with it. Mm-hmm. And it's because I've dealt with a lot of situations that made me, I dealt with a lot of situations in my life that, you know, made me be afraid of, you know, and it hurts differently when you got kids. Mm-hmm. But when it's just you, it's cool. You know, you eat a bag of chips and you go to sleep. You eat the dollar menu at McDonald's. Mm-hmm. But when you have kids, it's not the same. So as a marketer, I try to bring with myself the good parts about trying to prove yourself, which is the, you know, the drive. Mm-hmm. And I try to translate that in the way I put passion in what I do. I only work, and I used to work with companies that I believe in and with people that I believe in, because if I don't, I cannot manufacture that. and you cannot promote prep
right
at all. So every time I choose to work with people, I did it unless, you know, it was some cases where I had to work because I needed the money. But mostly, you know, now that I'm more, I guess, grown in the industry as an entrepreneur, where I have the chance to and I have the power to choose, what I like doing is working with people that I really can believe in, so I can go and, you know, make that shit work and make it happen. And I really like that. Mm-hmm. So adversity made me bitter in a way. And it's something, you know, that I have, you know, I have no shame in, you know, in saying it, because I'm dealing a lot with the imposter syndrome, you know, firstly, because where I'm from, secondly, because I'm a woman, thirdly, because of the language barriers and the culture barriers that are, you know, with the Romanians in general. Mm-hmm. But, and I know you both can relate to that. And it's, you know, it's whatever, man. Like, at the end of the day, it is what it is. I'm still showing up every day, you know, and I'm doing everything I can. And, you know, I guess the only way I could get so far where I am, and I'm rubbing shoulders with all these cool brands and cool people right now, is because I worked, you know. I never, you know, gave up.
I relate to that. And I know Dre relates to that. Like, we come from, so I could never understand the struggle that my parent went through, because my dad raised me as a single parent, and Dre's mom raised him as a single parent. So I can't, I'm, as a product of that, I have so much reverence for my father, because, and not, you know, like, typically you hear of the mothers too. So it's just like, I have even more reverence, because it's a completely different animal for a father to step in as both. It's different. Mm-hmm. Right. And then I relate to that double-edged sword. And I'm going to tell you one thing, cause you just opened up right now. Last night, I'm in a really great place financially. You know, it's completely new to me sometimes. So mm-hmm. last night I had a discrepancy with a client, and it triggered, like, the client, like, I don't need the client, but it was one of my oldest clients, and it was like a silly little thing. It was just, the client was upset, wondering why I didn't respond to one thing. And they were not even upset, but I painted that picture with all of my trauma. And I immediately thought, oh my God, if I lose this client, like, what am I gonna do? I'm gonna be broke again, blah, 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 blah. All of that came up. And I'm telling you, I do a lot of breath work. I'm big into therapy, all that shit. I felt myself kind of have a panic attack. I was like, I haven't had this, like the startings of it, you know, like, of wondering to, like, feeling broke again. It is a trauma. It's a real trauma. Mm-hmm. And I immediately played all these worst case scenarios. Like, you know, I'm going to let my family down. I'm going to do all of this. I'm not doing enough. Like, I need to put out more content, you know, like, I need to make more money. I need to hit that, you know, that 50K mark, you know, like 50K a month mark. Like, what am I doing? I'm fucking slacking. All of that came up at once. And then me feeling like I'm not enough. Like, meanwhile, I'm just like, dude, a year ago, I would have been so proud. I would have been amazed at where I'm at now. I would consider that the top. Mm-hmm. But now it's like, even at the top, and this is just, you know, I feel like I'm only just starting, because I'm only like 5 years in. Even at the top, I feel you still feel that you battle these demons. So I completely understand with that drama. I completely understand that double-edged sword. I try to take that energy, and this is what I try to do. And like I said, it's a constant work in progress. And like you said, like, I don't know if it ever ends, but I try and take that energy and I try to, like, understand it. I try to understand where it's coming from. I try to tell it that it's crazy, because it is crazy, right? It's not logical at all. And I try and use that to make me a better marketer, a better professional overall, better to my clients, more understanding, you know, like, developing better relationships and more honest relationships, all across the board. And it's a really strong ripple effect. So it's that double-edged sword that I really make work for me. All the coolest people that I know, my dad included, have this chip on their shoulder. But the thing is, like, they don't let that chip let them be bitter, because sometimes it can be poison. And I know that, because I've gone through cycles of burnout doing a million things at once. Like, I get that. And last night I kind of felt that little bitch come in, creep in again. I was like, nope. We're gonna do our breathing exercises. We're gonna talk this out. We're gonna be healthy about it. But I still felt it. And mm-hmm. and that trauma, it triggered literally everything. So I just want to say thank you for sharing that. I felt that shit last night. I don't really get it often. And like, just as a single parent hustling, learning everything that you possibly can, I relate to that on a fucking spiritual level. And kudos to you to constantly, you know, because Juliana is amazing on LinkedIn, by the way. That's where I met her. Juliana is kind of like a LinkedIn influencer. She's,
yeah.
One thing I loved about Juliana, and like, she said this to me. She was like, you know, I feel comfortable not code switching with you. I was like, oh shit. like, I would love to delve into that a little bit more, but I was just like, thank you for even saying that, because sometimes we feel like LinkedIn is rigid, and sometimes we feel like you can't really be yourself, but Juliana, you make it a safe place to be yourself regardless of where you're at. And I'm amazed by your story and how you're able to use like your career in marketing, your career and your background in music to really like just push everything to that next level. Your creativity, the fact that, you know, like I can tell that you're ballsy within music. It's just your music choices there.
Yeah, facts.
She had the audacity to say that she likes, she's not really with the New York rap scene.
I am. I like it. I like it.
No, don't backtrack. Don't. You said what you said.
Listen, my top five. Be Jay-Z.
No, I'm just kidding. You're right.
Wait.
That's true. The fact that you're so bold in it, I think that is like the cornerstone and one of the winning qualities of a great marketer, because you're not afraid to speak your mind. You're not afraid to go against the grain.
Yeah. So one of the things I want to highlight too, that you said, is like, you still show up, right? Because at the end of the day, I think it's important. Like, I have a very similar, I guess, like, it's so, like, I can relate to what you're saying so much, because I grew up in a family where my family was super competitive, and, you know, one of my family members was kind of like, she used to like belittle me a lot and tell me I was dumb and I can't do this and I can't do that. And to what happens to the average like kid is like, they take that and they grow up with it, and they're like, you know, they're affected, their confidence is affected. But for me, I guess, because like when I would go home at night and I'm talking to my mom, and my mom is telling me, you can do whatever you want. You can be the best thing in the world. Like, you can do whatever. What happened was, is that I feel like that's what built up my competitive spirit, because I have somebody telling me you can't do this, and then I have somebody else telling me you can do this. So now when this person is telling me that you can't do this, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna prove you wrong. So I felt the same way that you felt. Like, I felt like I always have to prove people wrong. And that honestly, like, it took me really far, but then I had to realize where it was like toxic for myself and had to kind of step out of it, because sometimes like I would just do things off of, all right, I just want to prove to this person that I'm way better than them. Like, I want to be the best. And the reason why I want to be the best is because I just feel like it's like just a drive from within, from my childhood, that I didn't even realize was really what was driving that force. And so I think that one of the things that it's important to realize is, first off, when that happens, you know, taking a step back and realizing where it's coming from. But then I think that it's also important. I think the benefit is that at least you're still showing up. So for people that's like you, they can see you and say, oh, Juliana's doing this and I want to do this as well, and I can be like Juliana. And that's super, super important, to show other people that you can do whatever you put your mind to, no matter what bound, no matter what limitations you have, or no matter where you've grown up or where you're from or your color or the language that you speak, right? Like, it's good for people to look at you and say, you know what, she's doing this, I'm gonna do this as well. And I think it's always good to kind of be that staple for them.
That's why we made this podcast, honestly, because I feel like in every situation I'm in, I'm either the only female or the only Latina. And I know Dre feels very similar about being in SEO, you know, so it's just like showing face.
How many black people do you see in SEO? Like, let's get the cat out of the bag.
Jared and Michael King.
Yeah. And
I know,
and
what's his name?
William. There's another guy called like William Ray Reynolds or something like that from Sierra Interactive.
Reynolds from Sears. Yeah. I know him.
Those are the only people. Those are the only black people I've ever seen in SEO that I can think of right now.
We'll make a joke. I'll tell it after the.
We'll keep it a little PC here. We'll keep it a little.
Yeah, I have something funny. My husband says, but I'll keep it for.
We'll keep it for the after credits, or for the after show.
For the bloopers.
Yeah, for the blooper reel with Juliana with when it comes to CBO, like. I just want to transition into that. I know that with your background, you're big on customer relations and actually squeezing all of the juice out of, not necessarily prospecting, but making the most out of the customers that you do currently have. And it kind of goes back to like the conversation that we were having about relationships. And I can tell the passion that you have for this. I mean, like I follow your content on LinkedIn. So I would love to know from your perspective, what is that? Because I feel like it's a relatively new term. You're talking about how this was relatively new in 2016, 2017. I still feel like it's relatively new in 2021. So what is CBO? Yeah. What does that mean to you? And how can you, actually, I won't convolute it. What is CBO? What does it mean to you?
So CBO, customer value optimization, is not a new concept. It's something that exists, but no one ever claimed this category of software, because you know a category, you can either have services or you can have a software. Mm-hmm. So customer value optimization is just a process that helps you create customer journeys and maximize the profits that you have from all your marketing activities, because it's focused on the customer life cycle and it focuses on improving the brand's loyalty and the brand, relationship with their customers on the long term. So the biggest, part about the customer value optimization is the customer lifetime value and tracking, measuring, and improving it. We got to in this category back in 2016. The company that I work for, OmniConvert, is a conversion rate optimization company. So we started doing conversion rate optimization. We have a software that does that. But working with so many agencies, we have seen that working with conversion rate optimization agencies, we have seen that the basic contract length for doing a CRO is from 6 to 9 months. Mm-hmm. And after that point, it becomes a bit obsolete in the sense of sustainable growth. Yep. Because it's only focused on what happens on the website. It doesn't cover the whole journey of a customer, which is, post-purchase and, whatnot. So seeing that, my boss Valentin said that we need to do something in this, sector, because retention is going to be the next best thing. So ever since then, I met Valentin in 2019. I was looking for a job. I got rejected by McDonald's because I was desperate to get a job, because I couldn't get hired, by the way. They rejected me because I was too qualified to flip fucking burgers, right? Yeah. So I applied to his job and he called me in the same day, and I went to the interview in the same day, and he hired me immediately. I don't know still to this day why. So he gave me this chance, and ever since 2019 until today, we have been warning people about, the fact that retention is gonna overpower acquisitions. And I know you won't like this.
No, I know.
I'm kidding. I'm just shit talking. But
yeah.
Retention. We were, and I was like super petty the other day when Shopify announced that retention is the new thing, and then you see big agencies that moved from conversion rate optimization to customer lifetime value optimization. Yeah. And when I was saying that, then everyone was like, man, get the fuck out of here. Like, who cares, So like no one listened to us. But now, we, by broadcasting this message so much in the market, we are seen as the change faces, because we have been relentless in helping people improve the relationships that they have with their customers. So we were lucky to have been working with so many big brands and switch their whole game up, focus on retention and, doing smarter acquisition and email marketing and so on. And right now we are the category kings for customer value optimization, because if it's a software that people think about in terms of, you know, optimizing post-purchase, they will think about us.
Yeah.
So we don't identify ourselves as a customer data platform, as a CDP. We identify as a customer value optimization platform, because unlike a CDP, we don't only come with quantitative data. We come with qualitative data as well. So we gave you a story. So, you know, it was that outcast verse. You know, I saw you liked your wife to divorce you. This is what we are telling you to, like, how your customers liked you, wifed you, mm-hmm. divorced you. And, you know, that's long story short. So customer value optimization is focused on building relationships with your customers, growing your retention, doing smarter acquisition. So basically it's optimizing all the channels that you do marketing on.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But you have to look at one thing, and that thing is the ratio between the lifetime value and the acquisition cost. So then is when shit goes bad, because there's not a big number of brands that know how to calculate their acquisition cost, right? Mm-hmm. It's a very difficult metric, because acquisition cost is not only what you spend on ads.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Acquisition cost is your overhead, is your salaries, is your tools, is your agencies, mm-hmm. is your, I don't know, the lights. It's everything. So right. You, in order for you to have a clear number of how much you are spending to acquire customers, you have to know how to calculate it, right? So let's say you do and you calculate it, you have to make sure that you know to what extent is it worth for you to invest in acquiring new customers based on how much they spend with you during their lifetime. And if you know the answer to that question, then you will know if your business is going down or is going up. And unfortunately, the culture right now, and I posted about this today on LinkedIn, is like every e-commerce brand is trying to recreate Amazon on their fucking shop. Like, everyone is doing the same thing.
Right, right.
I'm dropping gems right here in your podcast the first time.
Let's go.
Where's the Jamaican horn? I have to pull that. I said today, like, all the brands are trying to recreate the Amazon model in their store. And what I mean by that, I mean a lot of shit, but what I mean by that is that you cannot reproduce the model of a marketplace on your direct to consumer brand, because yep. people are obsessed with sales. They think that their whole problem in this world is making sales. Yeah. It's great. You have to do sales, but sales should work in tandem with your retention. You cannot separate these channels, because people think, oh my God, I got this sale going on. Shit. You know, I'm making money. I'm going to be Clay David. Yep. You know, like, I'm making money, but then, you know, like, you don't think that, you know, that money is never coming back, because I'm telling you, 80% of the business after one customer purchased the first time mm-hmm. from them, it's only 25 chance for them to come back and purchase again mm-hmm. in a good day. So yeah. the chances for a new customer to purchase again from you after their first purchase are very low, because after the first purchase, you are probably not doing what you're supposed to be doing to make sure that that person is going to buy from you again. And think about it. How many times you purchase from a brand and the next thing they tell you is to purchase some more.
Yeah.
So they that's it.
Yep.
Right. But you are not, like, there's so many things you can do post-purchase, like do different onboarding flows. Actually, do onboarding. Stop sending that boring welcome message. No one reads. Right. You know, the only check.
Yeah.
You know what's crazy about the welcome message? That's the most open one. You know why? Because people are trying to find out about their order. So if in that welcome message you are boring as fuck, who cares?
Right.
Like, there's your chance. You have two chances as a brand mm-hmm. to stand out. One is the welcome message, because after you buy, you are waiting on the confirmation of your purchase. You used your card, right? So you're on your phone and you're waiting. So you're going to open those emails, the first right. emails from a brand, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
You yeah. want to see, like, yo, did I pay? You know, is it good? Is it coming? So those are the, you know, the things that you will see. And then the other thing is the unboxing campaign. And in the unboxing campaign, there is your chance to stand out. You know, like, you open a box and you should be doing something for that person, because if, you know, like, I ordered this Vaseline from Amazon, because we don't have Vaseline in Romania, this one.
That's insane.
You know, like, I found nothing. Like, they would have said, you know, like, this is a bad example, but when you buy something from a store, you're you're opening it. Exactly. You're in a good mood. You receive your product. So there is where you can stand out. Like, if you, I don't know, sell cameras or whatever, send a sticker or a note or something, you know, anything is better than nothing, right? So there's a lot of things that can be done, just to sum up, post-purchase, that can contribute to the growth of your customer lifetime value. And that's where we are at right now.
I got a couple of things to tie into that. I completely agree. I love how CVO is basically, for what sounds like to me, like a really nice way of saying data-driven branding, right? Something that I do when it comes to ads, I think my unique perspective on advertising, I think you're going to like this, is that I really take this holistic approach where I'm looking at, I always ask my clients to send me send me the product, send me a sample of the product, because I want to see what it's like, the opening experience. I want to actually go through the post-purchase flows. And even through that, yeah, your camera's a little blurry, but that's okay. Something that I'm adding on, actually moving into 2021, is actually email, like an email service, because I think email and e-commerce, paid and e-commerce, go hand in hand. It's absolutely essential to really close that gap, to build that customer relationship. Not just that, even like text. I think text is the big thing nowadays, and it's going to get a little convoluted. We use text for order updates and things like that, and then email, we try and use that more to develop the relationship. And even the types of clients that I have. So you mentioned, and I'm jumping around the place because I just want to make sure that I comment on everything that you said. You said something along the lines of, man, everyone's trying to be like Amazon. What's up with that, right? I think that is a really big problem on an overall marketing branding level, because you're not correctly positioning yourself. The clients that I work with, and I'm very particular about the clients that I work with, they have a signature product, and everything else with that signature product are kind of like upsells in order to make that a full experience. For example, I have a client that sells ballistic helmets. They sell a variety of different helmets, but they have that one signature helmet that they're known for.
Seller,
yeah, that's their anchoring. You know, it's very important to position yourself in the marketplace to anchor yourself, even with a signature product, and everything else is just accessories, really. So that's how we build up our, like, I'm thinking from a paid acquisition point, the goal is to build up our overall lifetime value and our overall average order value in order to bring up profit, right? So for me, I completely relate to what you're saying. And this is how I'm actually enhancing my services as a paid media advertiser. I'm looking to really assist clients to build out that entire customer relationship, and to truly make impact and to build revenue, adding email along with that. And then having this mentality of like CVO or C, how do you call it? CVO, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's just that I think like, I'm going to figure out how to like talk about that more in the type of like, my overall positioning, because that's help me with that, because that's really the secret sauce that I have. And I know it's Dre's secret sauce with SEOs. Like I'm honestly, at the end of the day, I'm a business consultant. I anchor in my services with advertising, but I'm really like taking full account into the entire user experience from the minute that they open up an ad, or the minute that they Google something and they, you know, read this article, then how I'm retargeting them, and then how I'm emailing them and speaking to them overall. So I think this is like, even when it comes to SEO, like this is the future. Like you were talking about this yesterday, Dre, like it's about brand, building that customer relationship. Even how Google is now ranking you based on like your branded terms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's super important, you know? And that's the one thing that I never understood, you know, like when I was working at jobs and I would work with, you know, agencies and stuff like that. And I would look at how they would do stuff for their clients. And it was just like this one aspect, like just yeah. SEO, just doing this one thing. When ultimately, like, you have to understand the bigger picture of what the business is trying to accomplish, and also take a more holistic approach to make sure that you're helping that company grow in revenue, which is things like, you know, CVO. So I think it's really important. And it definitely hits hard.
I think this is secret sauce. I think that's the secret sauce to any performance marketer, is understanding CBO and not going directly for the sale.
Yeah. You know? I literally had I lectured one of my clients about this. Like, I was just like, yo.
I just didn't know the word for it.
I told them, I was like, man, you're focusing. Like, they were just like, yeah, we need to get the sale. And I'm just like, yo, like, look, we want to get the sale, but it is important. But look, like, we need to focus on these people over here, because these people over here are what is most important for your business, right? Like, yeah, we need to get you more sales. We need to do all this stuff. But like, or let me not say most important, but goes hand in hand. You know what I mean? So yeah, 100%.
Yeah. And I think this is a great, like, this is the only podcast where you're going to hear like rap stories, crazy, like come ups, things like that, that in a combination of CVO and marketing and how it can enhance your overall performance. This is crazy. But Juliana, I do want to wrap this up. I know you have a hard stop. What's one tidbit? What's one mic drop that you would leave to a marketer, you know, looking to level up in their game, trying to provide the best service for their clients? What's your mic drop?
Talk to your customers. Like, the biggest problem. That's it.
That gave me chills. Like, that is a mic drop.
Hold up. Let me do this again. I have 5 more minutes, but I really want to do this for you guys.
Oh, the horns?
We got to get more advanced. Yeah.
Yeah, we do. We do. We got to step it up.
But listening to your customers. She's going for it. She's going for it. Listening to your customers. Let's go.
Yeah.
I love it.
Listen, like, if you're in marketing, you cannot learn marketing if you're not in the market. So a lot of marketing nowadays is based on assumptions. So a lot of people think they can come and do marketing and, you know, they come up with shit out of their ass. And whatever comes up, you know, out of your ass, and if sometimes it feels relieving, it's still shit. So the best thing you can do as a marketer is to go ahead and talk to your customers and listen to your customers. And if you're selling your services as a marketer, as a consultant, this is the best advice I can give to people, because it's something I never was given, is to go ahead. And when you talk to your clients, to think about the customers those clients are serving, not right. about the client himself, mm-hmm. because that's the long-term game. And with CVO, I feel it's going to take over a lot of aspects of the industry right now, like advertising, like SEO, like, you know, email marketing, because it's everything encompassed. It's everything, the whole customer journey. So the coolest thing about CVO is that it's really, really looking at the whole journey of a customer. So you can do so many things as an advertiser, or from an SEO perspective, or from an email marketing perspective, conversion rate optimization perspective, and just, you know, put them all together and, you know, delight your customers. That's the best thing that, you know, everyone should be focusing on, how to delight your customers. I don't see it well with the whole cookie thing that's happening right now.
Yeah.
I want to be the first person on your podcast to announce that most likely Facebook and Google and Twitter and Instagram are going to do their own, you know, Amazons, and they will probably fuck a lot with the whole website experience. And, you know, the most important thing is going to be the ownership of your own data. So focus on your first party data and your zero party data. Make sure you have ownership, because the third party data is going to disappear. It already, you know, it was already removed from Twitter and Facebook. Now it's going to be removed from Google as well. So focus on protecting your data. That's the biggest takeaway and advice I can give to folks right now.
Juliana, you heard it from the best. Thank you so much. I think that's awesome. And you know, I'm dealing with the whole first party stuff and attribution.
I know I can help you with that.
Yeah, we'll talk offline. I'm gonna need your help. But
I work with a lot of advertising companies right now that are trying to move towards customer value optimization, and we do this for free for everyone that's interested in adopting this to their business. We help the agencies and consultants learn the methodology for free. Holla at me. I do this anyway, so why not doing it?
I'm very interested. Everyone hit up Juliana Jackson. Follow her on LinkedIn.
Facts. Hit her. Yo, we're gonna leave a link. I know you got to jump, but I'm just gonna say this real quick. We're gonna leave a link to all of your social media channels and everything, and where everybody can find you. LinkedIn, right? So we'll leave that. We'll leave that, and also I'll blast this episode out in our email, and we'll tell everybody about you. Thanks for coming on the show, and really enjoy it. We really enjoyed
having
you.
Thank you for having me. And
you have to come back. You have to come back.
Oh, you gotta wait. Play one more time. Play one more time. Let's hear it.
Yeah.
There we go. Juliana Jackson, thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm really running right now. Thank you so much.
All right.
Take care, all.
Take care.
Bye.
Bye now.